Welcome back, everyone, to the Ham and Turkey. We are here again to discuss some Michael Jordan last dance slash GOAT debate, just a little bit. Again, as you see, we have Chester on today, my resident basketball expert. Sorry that it took so long. My boy had to get a new phone.
After yeah.
5 weeks. This was supposed to happen. Yeah, bro, it was a long it was a long time.
And no, it was the shipping. The shipping messed it up.
But finally, my boy got a new phone, so we can finally. Actually, it kind of worked out because this is the last week of the Last Dance, so there'll be episodes 9 and 10 tomorrow. So we've gotten the first 8 episodes. So I kind of just want to talk about what we've learned through this whole thing leading up to the end. Stuff that you learned. Stuff that you already knew, but it was confirmed. Stuff that surprised you. Just your overall reactions to the first 8 episodes of The Last Dance.
It was enlightful. I'll say that. I was intrigued by everything. I liked the show. I liked the series. Mm-hmm. I don't know what to say, man. I just liked it. You won't hear a complaint about me. A complaint from me about the series.
Yeah, I think it was I think one of the things that I didn't know was, first and foremost, at the beginning of his career, what he actually had to deal with his teammates, with them being like cocaine addicts and like drug addicts and all that. I didn't know that. And then, like, I do like how the documentary goes into like Scottie Pippen's backstory and then how he got to be where he is, and then Dennis Rodman's backstory and how he got to be where he is. But ESPN had already did a 30 for 30 on Dennis Rodman, so we kind of already knew about him. But I like the fact that they went into like a lot of his supporting cast and like a lot of the people who made him him. And they went into Phil Jackson and they talked about his backstory and then how all that stuff culminating. I like how they go back and forth, you know, from his early days to 98, because that's where the documentary takes place, is the 1998 season. That's Jordan's last season as a Bull. So I think that was a great, whoever did the documentary did a really good job of doing that and like trying to frame Jordan's whole career and giving it to us in like 10 episodes. I know that it could probably go longer if you really wanted to, but I mean, I think that was interesting. Also, another thing that I found interesting was how much I didn't know he hated Isaiah Thomas that much.
That happens when somebody scrape you a lot.
Yes, they did. He did, yeah. That forced him to start lifting weights and forced him to – what he said it was, he wanted to start dishing out punishment instead of taking a punishment because they was trying to destroy him, injure him.
I do want to say this because it's just getting absurd for Jordan. Those kind of fouls were happening all the time to everybody else. It's only a problem when you talk about Jordan getting fouled like that. Like, it was a time where Isaiah Thomas was playing the Bulls and one of the players hit him with an elbow and his eye was bleeding. He was bleeding from the eye. And nobody said nothing about it, but Jordan got fouled hard. And I was, oh, Jordan. Those kinds of fouls happen. Like, you look in history, any time in the NBA, before like Detroit Pistons and Jordan, you will see those fouls.
I mean, well, it wasn't just somebody was, oh, Jordan. It was like they were literally trying to injure this man while he was in. I mean, me and you, we both know how dangerous that is to try to foul somebody while they're in midair.
But that's what I'm saying. If you look at the series before them, like a Bird and Magic series, you'll see those same kind of fouls.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm saying. Like, it wasn't that Jordan was the first player to get fouled like that. No, those were regular routine fouls then. Like, they were fighting then. Like, people were getting their nose broken and stuff like that back in those NBA days.
Yeah, and I mean, and that is a great point. You're right. Dudes was literally, like, squaring up, fist fighting, like they was in the streets or something. Like, yeah. It was definitely bad. But, I mean, they hadn't had a play. Well, I wouldn't say hadn't, but there was no player like Michael Jordan at that time in the league. I mean, you see all these guys.
That's literally what you're taught from grade school. I mean, from a kid. If somebody is – all they can do is score, and if they score in the paint, your coach going to tell you, yo, don't let them get the shot up. That's what they teach you. If you go and foul them, don't let them get the shot up.
Yeah. But I like what I like the fact is that he adjusted, though. You know what I mean? Like, it ate at him so much that he didn't give up. You can say what you want, like, oh, the team got old or whatever the case may be, but that's kind of, like, out of his control. Like, all you can do is, you know.
But play. I don't think that – I don't think anything changed for Jordan. Did his numbers change? I think the biggest change came from – everybody said the biggest change for Jordan to win in advance was when they was following the crap out of Scottie Pippen. And yeah. He didn't get up and do nothing. He just shrugged it off, like, all right, that's a regular foul. And then that's when they was like, all right, we can't do nothing with him.
Yeah.
And they was wasn't like, getting underneath. That's one thing I learned from this series. You wasn't getting to Jordan. Like, yeah. Jordan got thick skin.
Right. And he was going to get his buckets regardless of whether you fought him or not, you know what I mean? But it was everybody else around him. I'm actually – it's great that we're talking about this. I'm actually reading the book, Jordan Rules, and I'm going to give it to you after – it's a great book for any LeBron fan who wants ammunition against Michael Jordan. It's an awesome book. So the guy saying, "No, I'm being honest."
He's listen. Investigative reporting.
If you want ammunition about Michael Jordan, read Jordan Rules, and you'll get as much ammunition as you need.
I think that's the biggest problem or the biggest misconception that people are going to have with me is that I am not a Jordan hater. I love Jordan. I just respect and admire what LeBron does more. That's it.
That's a debate we'll have, but I'm just the book goes into like basically to sum the book up. I haven't got through the whole thing, but based from what I'm reading so far, is it's all about chronicling how bad of a teammate Michael Jordan was from before he won his first championship, how unbearable he was. Like, you see it some in the documentary, like, especially the last two episodes that just happened. You see how he was, like, cussing at his teammates and, like, ridiculing them and saying all that stuff. Listen, personally, I'm cut from the Kobe cloth. That's my guy. So I don't have a problem with any of this, you know what I'm saying? But it's this now generation. It's these generation now of these softer players. Like, they have an issue with people talking to them like that. Like, Shannon Sharp was all up in distress because he was like, yo, if Mike talked to me like that, we'd fight. And that's probably true. If Mike talked to me like that, I'd probably fight him too. You know what I'm saying? But he was making a point like the ends doesn't justify the means. And I was like, I mean, your job is to win championships, and they won 6 championships 3 different times. So it's like, I don't know. Can you really be that upset with him because he was acting like that? And then all his teammates were saying like, yo, we hated it at the time and he was a jerk, but we needed that. You know what I'm saying? You're not going to like it at the time, but you need a kick in the behind every now and then to get you going. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. No, but.
I'm just saying.
I mean, listen, you were the same person that called LeBron a bad teammate.
But LeBron, but there are articles and there are people who can attest to LeBron doing stuff. See, LeBron's passive aggressive, which is the worst type of bad teammate because he won't address stuff directly. And you know I'm wrong. You know I'm right, bro.
Okay, so hold on. So you're telling me it's better to not address anything in public matter. That's bad. But to just basically dehumanize your teammates when you're talking to them because you want to win, that's okay. Like, no. Like, you're not like –
I'm not going to sit here and say that he didn't take it too far. I won't sit here and say that. But what I am saying is that there are excessive ways to motivate that can be less dehumanizing. That's the word you use. That's less dehumanizing. Now, did he go overboard? He probably, I mean, basically he was saying, yeah, I went over. We saw the clips. Yeah, he went overboard calling them bees and all that stuff. That's the one word. I don't care how much trash I talk. I don't use the P word and I don't use the B word. I try not to use any of those words because those, like Shannon Sharp was saying, those are just words that you just don't refer to another man as.
Yeah.
And so so you can say that he went overboard, but like I said, if the end justifies the means, I'm not gonna argue with it, and I feel like his teammates wasn't arguing with it either.
Oh my goodness, this
except for Horace Grant.
This is sad.
I'm being real. What about Horace? What do you think about Horace Grant, bro? I never studied his career. This documentary was great because I never like knew about him. I just knew he was a dude with the goggles, and I knew he was a finisher.
Oh, no, but I used to try to tell you about him, you know, before you got the doc and everything, but you had never listened to me when I used to tell you that he's nice. And, like, literally, he showed that he was as big of a factor as you can be for a power forward.
Not a Hall of Famer, though. Four-time all-defensive selection, and I know he made the All-Star team a couple times, too, but not a Hall of Famer. That's the only point I ever try to make. If I'm mixing some GOAT debate in this, that's the only point I ever try to make. I never say that he didn't have any good teammates. I never ever say that. I just say that LeBron has played with more Hall of Famers than Jordan, and that's a fact. That is a whole fact.
That is not really. It's not, because he didn't play with all those Hall of Famers at the same time. He literally played with two Hall of Famers at two different stages in his career, the same way Jordan did.
He played with three Hall of Famers.
Okay. The player that he was playing with, were they playing at a Hall of Fame level at that time? Because I know, like, you just go, you play word semantics. I got you, EJ.
Time out. I'll
get you off of that.
Time out. So, the player that we are discussing, if y'all don't know, is Ray Allen. He disputes the fact that Ray Allen was a Hall of Fame.
No, I don't. I don't dispute that. But would you say that was a Hall of Fame year? Even with the shot that he hit to win it. No, I said, was that a Hall of Fame year? Was he a Hall of Fame player that year?
Was Ray Allen a Hall of Fame
player? Does the stat show that he was a Hall of Fame player that year?
No, he wasn't. He was in the ladder.
He was a great role player, correct?
Yes.
Oh. And it helped him win, correct?
Yes, he did. He hit one.
I just love how you can agree when it comes to LeBron, that teammates matter, and then as soon as we get to Jordan, it don't matter no more.
But in the documentary, he says that you can't mention Michael Jordan's name without Scottie Pippen, and I agree, because Scottie Pippen is a great player. I don't know why he's so disrespected. Like, yo.
It's because of you Jordan fans. Y'all speak on the 6-0, and y'all literally – make it only about Jordan. I never heard anyone say, yo, Jordan had a good team. Jordan had a Hall of Fame coach. That's why he won. Nobody ever says that. It's literally, yo, Jordan won. It's like, no, he didn't, because Jordan had 10 other seasons where he didn't win.
But he was putting up the same numbers. And like,
exactly. So that it don't matter. You get that literally.
He didn't win. I would agree with you. But there, he made the All-Star team. I mean, he made the playoffs every year of his career. So, yes, you can say that he didn't win, but, I mean, it took Jerry Krause and those guys time to get players around Jordan. I mean, in the book, Jordan Rules, it talks about how Jordan wanted a lot of the players, and then Jerry Krause would shoot them down. You know what I'm saying? And, of course, that would make you upset. So, basically, in the book, Jordan Rules, it makes Jordan look the same as LeBron did with his teammates. That's why I say if you were Jordan
– But it's – how? How?
In terms of the bad teammate.
No, because you still haven't told me the passive aggressive
when he be calling, when he was calling Kevin Love out on Twitter, talk about some don't fit in, fit out. Remember that? That's passive aggressive.
But who said that was about Kevin Love? Where is your sources that confirm that that was about Kevin Love?
That was a tweet he put out. There's no source. He put that out.
Okay, so you telling me that you got the definition and the meaning from LeBron that's saying that that was about Kevin Love?
Everybody knew that that tweet was about Kevin Love.
Okay.
Because Kevin Love had made a statement in the media like before, like, I'm trying to fit in.
I think, you know what, I'll give you that. Because I think that's when he just, like, dipped on him.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that was like a couple weeks before, because he dipped on him like Christmas Day or something like that. Like,
I don't recall, but whatever.
And, like, LeBron does passive aggressive stuff all the time. All I want people to understand is that. Now, I'm reading a book, Jordan Rules, and it's making me realize that Jordan did some of that same stuff LeBron did, just not as passive-aggressively, but he did.
No, I don't think it's that it's not as passive-aggressive. He's blatantly disrespectful. Like, what are we talking about? Like, you're basically condemning somebody being disrespectful to win. I would rather somebody be passive-aggressive any day. If you got something to say and you say it over there, I don't know the meaning, that's cool. You're entitled to your feelings. You're entitled to that. But to talk into somebody any old kind of way because you want to win, that's not respect. That's not being a good human at all.
I mean, I can see your point. I guess I'm just of the mindset because coming from a football background where we got talked to like that all the time, not in that manner, not that bad, but I've definitely been called the P word. I've definitely been called the B word. Talk to any of our football teammates. We've been called stuff. You know what I'm saying?
I've been in practice and always so I get it. I've been listen as a kid playing. I understand you can get in practice, you can get in the heat of the moment, you can say some things you don't mean, but to do that on a consistent basis, man, that's different. So it's not like he got 30 game seasons. These are these are like 6 months at a time that you're spending with somebody. You're basically doing everything that you can do with somebody in that kind of time. You stuck with them on a plane, you stuck with them on a bus, stuck with them at a hotel.
So what is your overall take on Jordan's leadership style?
On his leadership? I mean, I just don't like it. I know, because me and you hoop, and I talk junk, but I never cross that line. No. I know where the line is. I know how to talk junk to people and how to get something out of them without being disrespectful. So I just don't respect it.
Yeah, I can agree with you there. There you can be a motivator, but you can't be disrespectful. I will agree with that. That you can't cross that line. You know what I'm saying? Like I said, I play ball all the time too, and I try to not cross the line ever. You know what I'm saying? So I mean, if I'm sitting here thinking about it, I don't know, man. I'm kind of on the Skip Bayless bandwagon, man. It's just like the end justify the means, bro. Especially, I'm accepting it more because when you hear his teammates' reactions to how they felt about it now, in hindsight, when they had 20 plus years to think about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, we kind of needed that.
If that person isn't
upset, I can't be that upset with it then.
I mean, but that you're not getting every teammate. You're not getting everyone that he's had a problem with. Because it's been, like you said earlier about his teammates before smoking crack and all that stuff. And you had players that came out that spoke up against that. Yeah. You're not interviewing everyone he's playing with. You just you're highlighting his 6 good seasons.
No one highlights 6 good seasons. The documentary starts off back when before he was even in high school.
You know what I mean? But it's highlighted.
People only measure 6 seasons from Jordan. Like I don't know where that's.
Okay, so when do we have a LeBron been to the finals more than him? So when we gonna talk about that?
Been to the finals more than
him. And he's leading him with less on some of these things.
Leading him how with less?
He led a team with, let's say, a year that they lost Dennis Rodman. That's in the playoffs. Say he lost Dennis Rodman in the playoffs and had to finish it out from the first series on out. Like they've already said in a couple of those interviews that they really needed Dennis.
They did. They really needed him.
And there's a title that LeBron could have on the shelf right now from Golden State if he could have had Kevin Love. He could have had two of them if he could have had Kevin Love and Kyrie.
I mean, we can't do what ifs for injuries. I mean, everybody gets affected by the injury bug. You know what I'm saying? Like everyone gets affected by the injury bug. So I mean,
it all depends on when it happens.
Like finals though, and I've stayed consistent with this from 2016. I've always said I do not count that finals because he didn't have his proper help. I said that all the time. I do not count that finals.
But it didn't start in the finals. That's what I'm saying. Like he had to get through the first round because I remember Kelly Olynyk taking him out. Yeah, Kelly Olynyk took him out in the first series.
Pulled his shoulder down. Then Kyrie got hurt in the finals when he tore
in the finals.
So I mean,
but I'm just talking about leading. Like it's been Jordan been there with him and Scottie, and he never won a title.
Yeah. No, I mean, if the GOAT, Michael Jordan GOAT. Is saying that you can't mention Scottie Pippen's name. You can't mention Michael Jordan's name without Scottie Pippen.
And that's where I'm going to say it. Coming from Jordan's mouth, I just want to ask EJ, when have you ever brought up Scottie Pippen when you bring up Michael Jordan?
Well, as I told you off camera before we even did this, I said, you know what? I'm glad I have been playing basketball for the last couple of years and studying the game to understand – you know, that this GOAT debate is more nuanced than I actually previously thought back in 2016. That was just on the surface GOAT debate, and there's more stuff, more factors that go into this GOAT debate. And one of the major factors is Scottie Pippen does not get enough love for how great he is. Like, for what he was doing, I mean, he was the first point forward. I don't count Magic, but he was the first point forward of his kind. You know, at a point in time, they were saying he was like the second best player in the league. So you got the two best players in the league on the same
team. He was.
Right. And so you got two of the best players on the same team. And I know that made the game a lot easier on Jordan. And I try to bring Scottie's, you know, impact up as much as I possibly can. Like I said, I love Scottie Pippen. I love the way he played. You look at all his highlights. He was athletic. He defended. He was a perimeter defender, help defender. He was long, athletic. Like, anything you wanted from a basketball player, you could do. And so, I mean, I just feel like these days he don't get enough respect for how great he actually was.
But it's not from the LeBron side. It's only from the Jordan fan side.
I can't speak for all the Jordan fans. I can just speak for myself.
Listen, we have other conversations on Wax about this, and I'm pretty sure if we go back and listen to it, you never bring up Scottie's name when you mention Jordan, ever.
I'm saying that my mind is reformed from back in 2016 when we did the other podcast.
Oh, okay.
My mind has changed. Okay. I'm glad we're doing something in 2020 where I have an extended basketball knowledge now, where I can speak more eloquently.
But why, when I was telling you that wasn't good enough? When I'm telling you, like, yo, he didn't win without Scottie, and you'd be like, all right, well, whatever. Like, why does it take all of this? Why do we have to be fronting on Jordan? Whenever somebody says, yo, he has Scottie, he didn't win without Scottie, every Jordan fan that I've ever talked to says, oh, well, he ain't win nothing without Jordan. Like, well, Jordan ain't win nothing without him. It's like, whenever you mention Scottie to a Jordan fan, they disrespect Scottie. Really?
I mean, I think it's because when you play second fiddle, though, it's tough to be like, what did he really do? And then on top of that.
No, it ain't. Because LeBron did it. LeBron and D-Wade did it. And they made it work.
I'm going to quickly break down those two relationships. So I'm going to start with Jordan and Scottie. So Jordan was already there. Scottie came into the league. You know, Scottie was kind of like a playful dude. He was real shy. Even in the documentary, the one, I forgot who the scout was. I think it was a coach who was saying that, you know, he could barely get two words. Like, he was mad shy. And then Scottie Pippen talks about how Jordan pushed him to be better. You know, and even when he came in, when Charles Oakley was still on the Bulls, he was saying, like, yo, I'm better than Michael Jordan. So he had the mindset, but he didn't have the work ethic. And even in the book, Jordan Rules, Jordan has said about Scottie, he was like, Scottie got the talent, but he don't have the drive. And so even Scottie says in the documentary that, yo, Jordan helped me get the drive. So I think that's kind of what it is like Jordan pushed him to be even better than what he even thought he could be. Like, we knew he could be good, but it took Jordan's push to make him better. Now,
I don't think it took Jordan's push, because okay, Jordan pushed him and what got him over.
But he said Jordan pushed him, though. He said that.
No, like I said earlier, it's not that I'm not discrediting anything Jordan did, because I believe Jordan helped him 100%. I'm saying, like, once they seen that he got the thick skin that Jordan had, the Detroit Pistons, all of them said it. Oh, once we seen we fouled Scottie and he didn't do anything, he ain't get mad, he didn't stretch or nothing, he just got up, went and shot his free throws, like nothing happened. Oh, we lost. Because if you can break down just half. That's all you really need to do in basketball is just bring somebody to half of what they can do. And that gives you an advantage.
Yeah. And
that's it.
I mean, you saw Scottie's impact that year before they won when Scottie got that migraine and he could barely see out there. You saw his impact on the game. I mean, they lost that game. I think it was a close game. I can't remember the score of the game, but they lost that game. And he was like, yo, man, if Scottie was there, we could have won. And it's just like,
yeah, I think that's the biggest indictment on Scottie's game. Scottie quit twice.
I'll get to that, because I was livid. I've
been new about that, though. I've been told you that.
I ain't never heard that he did that.
Told you that he quit on his team and that they was one win away. They was one series win away from the Eastern Conference Finals.
Yeah, I'll get to that. But I want to talk about LeBron and D-Wade's relationship first.
Go ahead.
LeBron and D-Wade's relationship is way different from Scottie and Pippen's relationship, just because we know the whole situation around that. So LeBron had just come off of losing to the Celtics in the Eastern Conference Finals. And so I think everyone pretty much knew he was going to leave Cleveland. You don't do a big, grand, drastic show to say that, oh, I'm going back to Cleveland. Obviously, you're going to say that you're going to somewhere else. So D-Wade had already won a chip with Shaq, where he was the man on that team. and he knew how to win already. So LeBron went with D Wade to show him how to win.
No, I was going to tell you. I was going to agree with that.
Right, and D Wade has said, he said, "Yo, I had understood very early on in that process that if LeBron was not our best player, we was not going to win." So no one had to show Jordan how to win. Jordan showed someone else how to win. Wade had to show LeBron how to win.
He didn't show him how to win. Like you said, he already had went to the finals. He could, like, he had to show him over the hump of the finals.
Is there another hump that he should be crossing then? Is there any more?
I mean, listen, that's not an experience everybody can speak on. Like, that's really hard.
Okay, so LeBron needed someone to help.
And once again, were there two Hall of Famers on that team?
Which team?
That D-Wade played on?
Shaq and who else?
And Dwayne Wade.
Okay, there's two Hall of Famers. No. I'm not counting Wade. So I'm saying Wade is the Hall of Famer. So that's one. And Shaq.
That's what I'm saying. Well, okay, so who was those years that LeBron was going? Because we about to get into the teammates matter debate again, and I hate this. So when LeBron was in Cleveland all those years, because just like you said, I'll say this about Jerry Krause. Jerry Krause might not be the most likable guy, but he has an eye for talent.
Yeah, I agree. He does.
Like the draft picks that he was bringing in with Scotty and the other pieces, he was putting winning teams together. Nobody will ever say in a right mind that first time that LeBron was in Cleveland, Dan Gilbert was putting together great teams. I remember there was a trade for J.J. Hickson and Amari and the Phoenix Suns, Amari Stoudemire. And they said, no, we don't want to do it because we want to keep J.J. Hickson.
Awful. That's awful.
That's the thing that a lot – like, Jordan get credit for that. But now that you get the backstory about what was really going on back there, like, they did a lot of stuff to win. And Scotty – I really hate Scotty contract. That was it.
That contract was awful, man. But I mean, see, that's the importance of having great people around you that understand business. I mean, that's one thing I can say speak to LeBron is like he has maximized his business opportunities not more than Jordan, but as much. I mean, he's worth $1 billion. Like all the endorsements he has a lifetime contract with Nike. Like you have to be able to maximize, you know, your business and your endorsements and your contracts and stuff like that. And that's where Scotty had lacked, man. Then he tried to postpone his surgery so he ain't messing summer up.
Hey, listen, I get it. It's a business.
I got it too. I definitely got it.
So, like, because you can't say it's a business on one side when they're paying him $2 million, but he's leading the team in everything but scoring.
He wasn't even the highest paid player on the team, on his team. Like he wasn't the second highest paid player on his team.
And that's my biggest thing was that's where I don't like him because I remember you tried to say that LeBron was a bad teammate for getting Tristan Thompson contract, and Jordan let Scotty go out like that.
My thing with Tristan Thompson and LeBron is me and you both know that the contract that he got was not worth that. I mean,
let's not say that because. We don't have the money to pay him. Somebody felt like that's what he was worth.
Was it 48 million or 80 million?
I think it was like 80. He might have been in the 100s.
It was 80.
He's up there in 70s, 80s.
Yeah. And so it was, that number was astronomical. And so
it wasn't, though. It made sense at the time.
I still don't think it made sense. I mean, I guess I don't think it made sense, bro.
It made perfect sense. So this is how it went. They just won the finals, correct?
I think so.
Just won the finals. You're not preparing for the Golden State Warriors to drop Harrison Barnes and get Kevin Durant. Because it's basically the same amount of money. So they probably figure like, all right, any small forward that they get, this is the kind of money that they're going to get. And I'm pretty sure that, like, you just can't calculate that. You can't calculate KD going to the Golden State Warriors.
I mean, I guess I read an article a while back about that whole thing, how KD ended up in Golden State. So what happened was the TV revenue money had kicked in that offseason. I think that was like the offseason of 16 or 17, I think.
Yeah.
And the revenue had went up. And so when the revenue goes up, the cap goes up. So obviously that gives you more leeway and more flexibility to spend more on players. So they were able to give KD the contract he wanted. You know what I mean? But you're absolutely right. They couldn't have forecasted that KD was going to go to the Warriors. I don't think anybody forecasted that. And actually took him seriously. How about that? There were always reports and rumors, but I don't think anyone actually took – I really wanted him to go to the Spurs that year. But he ended up –
I wanted him to stay in OKC. I thought the West was better with him.
That's like a whole different discussion, man, because then we got to start talking about Russell Westbrook. And we know how you
feel about Russell Westbrook. I don't have a problem with Russell. I'll leave Russell on.
But going back to Jordan, I think one of the other things that I took away from it was how much like fame and how much the toll of winning, how much that actually took a stress on him. Like what he had to do to appease everybody, what he had to do to meet like certain obligations, and like just everything with being Michael Jordan, how much being Michael Jordan took a toll on him. I always say like, if anybody asks me, like, what if, I always say, I'd rather have the money than the fame. Y'all can keep the fame because I don't really feel like it's ever worth it. And
it's never.
Right, and that's documentary. I feel like that kind of says the same thing. It's like, obviously, Jordan would have took the money. He would have took the endorsements and all that. But the fame is too much. Having, like, millions of people, you know, have certain expectations of you every single day to do something. And then on top of that, there's cameras in your face every day. Reporters ask you stupid questions. You know what I mean, all the time. Like the one scene they had when Scotty was crying and saying how much he loved the Bulls, and they kept trying to ask him about his contract. And he like, yo, why don't y'all go ask Scotty about his contract instead of keep asking me? And it's just like when you Michael Jordan, you got to deal with that times 12. And so it's just like, that's one of the things that I took away, is like how much fame actually took a toll on him. But it never took a toll on his basketball game. And that's one of the things that I noticed too. It never took a toll on how he performed on the court.
I mean, but that's just a credit to the work he put in, because that's a lot.
That is a lot.
That is a lot to pull from. You got to basically wearing yourself thin. You got to stretch to be everywhere at every time and still work on your craft. That's commendable.
Yeah, definitely. And one of the things that was interesting in that documentary that seems to be like a reoccurring theme is how much he loved competition. And so how much doing the fact that he loves competition, how much he actually gambled, you know. And people are coming out of woodwork saying, well, he did this much, or he did gamble this much or that much, like how much he like thrived on competition and how much he really, really, really wanted to win. Like you can say you wanted to win. Like everybody says like, yo, I'm competitive, or like, yo, I want to win. But there's a difference between saying you want to win and then actually doing the stuff you need to win on a consistent basis and living a life that's competitive. Like, if that makes sense. Like,
that's the difference between Jordan and LeBron. That's the difference. It's not a killer instinct. I just think it's a competitiveness. Like, Jordan wants to eat your heart out to show his competitiveness. LeBron can still be cool with you and still be competitive. I can understand if somebody wants somebody stepping on your throat for the win, that Jordan's your guy. If it doesn't bother you how you get it, as long as you're trying to get the win, then LeBron's your guy. But those are the two differences. There is no killer instinct. There's none of that. It's just he's going to like try to embarrass you, and LeBron's still going to be cool and try to win.
Right. It's just competitive.
It's still competitive. It's just a different – it's just different looks of competitiveness. That's all I got from it. I'll never say that Jordan or LeBron or anybody, I'll never interact with the killer instinct conversation again. I'll just say it's just different levels of competitiveness, because I know people, regular people, that's competitive on Jordan level, they just not good.
Yeah.
that was me. It's cool.
Yeah.
I like it though. I like somebody that's always down. And you can tell he's just doing it because that's what gets him high off life. Yeah. Just competing.
And I definitely, that's something I took from him. I try to internalize from him and Kobe. You know what I mean? Just like Because I always say, I always tell people, especially younger people, I'm like, yo, if you'll accept the win, if you'll accept the loss in Monopoly, you'll accept the loss anywhere. You know what I mean? You know, that's like the most extreme type of example, but I feel it rings true. It's just like, if you accept losing in the smallest and minute way, you'll accept losing in any other thing. You know what I mean? What if you're trying to prepare for a job interview and you need to go that extra mile and you're just like, ah, this all right. You know what I mean? And it's just like, no, it's about going that extra mile. It's about putting more work than anybody else is. Putting more work than the guy next to you. That's what's going to get you that job. And I feel like these are a lot of relatable, like a lot of things that Michael Jordan did in terms of his basketball career and how he went about it. There's a lot of transferable skills that can help you in life. And I think that's why I love, and I rewatch the documentary all the time. I think I watched Matt all the episodes like 3 or 4 times, but it's just always a good thing to watch to like apply to your life. When you see people who work relentlessly on their craft, and then they try to put that same and instill that same thing in you. Like when he was crying, talking about how he played the game, I totally understood where he was coming from. Totally understood where he was coming from.
Well, you talking about who? Jordan. I'd say, actually, back to what I was just saying, I would say the difference, I would say what got the most respect for Jordan for me is that the story's actually about the baseball season. Yeah. And how good he actually was really turning out to be before they locked out. Mm-hmm. And they were saying, like, yo, you don't – like, they were saying it's rare for a player, any player, to not play for 10, 12, 15 years and then come back and pick up the bat and still swing for almost 200.
Yeah.
And you're literally playing a whole different sport, a whole different regimen for your body. It doesn't really basketball and baseball exercise, they really don't mix.
Yeah.
So for him to just drop basketball and really pick that up because that's something he told his dad he wanted to do and he was actually good at it, like, that's another level.
Yeah. And, again, it's just a testament to, like you said, work ethic. Testament to just working hard. He said it took him 15 months to transform his body to play baseball. So, I mean, obviously that's a year.
That's a grind.
Hey, that's a grind. Like, to come back with the same intensity every day, it's tough. There's a difference between working out and training. Two different levels of working out.
Way different.
You know what I mean? When you're training, like, you're really trying to transform yourself, transform your body. That's training. Working out is going to the gym, running for 30 minutes, maybe lifting a couple weights and going home. That's working out. But training is totally different. And
training is a lifestyle. Working is that leisure.
It's a lifestyle. It's how you eat. It's how you sleep. It's how you work. It's everything. Yeah. It's people you put around you. It's your trainers. It's everything. And it's a meticulous way to move, but you have to move at to be the greatest at what you do. And like I said, I just love watching anything about Michael Jordan, like anything about Kobe, like those guys. And even LeBron, like, I don't want someone to watch this and take away that I don't love. I love LeBron. Like, I really do. Like, I think on a basketball court, I'm LeBron in little LA Fitness League. I try to emulate LeBron more than anybody because I love his game. But I think where I differ is just I prefer the cutthroat, step on your throat type of competitiveness to get the job done, whereas LeBron is one who's going to make the perfect basketball play to win the game. And then, like you said, you have a preference of which one you want. I mean, if you want someone who's going to make the right play, there's nothing wrong with that because that's what you're supposed to do. But if you want a dude that's going to take the ball and get you that bucket for the end of the game, I can't argue with either way. You know what I mean? I just feel Jordan has just a slight edge. I mean, I even said back at 16, the difference in GOAT from Jordan to LeBron, I don't think it's astronomical. It's not like LeBron is not there. Like, he's there, but he's just not surpassing Michael Jordan. That's all I've ever tried to say, ever tried to exclaim.
Yeah, I don't get it. Okay, I'm going to tell you this because we've went through this before. How does one player he's a leader in more stats than the other player, all but one, but that other player is better? Like, that's never been said ever. It's only in this debate that's even thought about. Like, there's never a time that the stats come out and the guy that's opposed from someone has better stats in every category except for one. And that other player, the player with that one category, is considered the better player.
Well, to speak to that, I think today there's more metrics. I know you're not really into advanced analytics like that, but there is a lot more metrics that people measure how great basketball players are. So, I mean, it's not like I said before, it's not as cut and dry as, oh, I average more points, rebounds, and assists than you. It's like, on in that 48 minutes that you're on the floor, what are you actually doing to help your team? Like, we'll go, for example, James Harden scores 51 points and takes 45 shots, shoots 30%, but everyone will only look at the fact that he scored 51. You won't look at the efficiency of what how he's shooting. You know what I'm saying? He gets 51.
Don't say I won't. Say the casual fan.
Excuse me, you're right. The casual fan will say, oh, yeah, but he had 51. But it's like, yeah, but the 51 is at the detriment of the team, which Phil Jackson even speaks to in the documentary when he says, yeah, Mike can go out and give us 40, but is he giving us 40 in the rhythm of the offense? You know what I mean? It's just like Kobe. Kobe used to bust the offense all the time to get his rocks off, which is why I don't put Kobe over LeBron if I'm thinking from a basketball perspective. And everyone who knows me knows I love Kobe. But Kobe used to bust the offense to get his shot off, and it was at a detriment to the team.
So there's only one. He was down 10 points.
If the Lakers down 10, he taking 20. He taking 10 straight shots. Might as well talk it up. He taking 10 straight shots. So that's how Kobe. That's how Kobe got his rocks off. But Michael Jordan is different because he'll be more efficient. And so back to the original point I'm trying to make. When you look at stats like PER, which Jordan is number one in. Look at stats like box plus minus or offensive plus minus. And you look at Jordan's number one in that. Just all these advanced analytics that people are now like looking at, and they're like, oh, well, let me dive deeper and see who was better than who. It's just like, no, it's not. It looks like Jordan is clear cut, but like I said previously, it's like, it's not as far away for LeBron as it may seem. But I think that's one of the things that go into it. There are more stats to justify why Jordan was as great as.
I mean, listen, I love Jordan, so let me give him this. Jordan, to me, is like, Jordan to me is what you're supposed to look like when you're putting in the right amount of effort.
That's a good way to put it.
That's what I would say. Because Jordan wasn't the tallest player. Like, the difference I give between Jordan and LeBron is that Jordan had to go through more fouls, but Jordan is also the smaller player. Mm-hmm. And for basically, he middle of the pack. You got 7-footers, you got people that 6 foot, and he's jumping with the 7-footers, and he's got the speed of the smaller guards. And that's just like that's real work. Like you don't just get that. That's not a gift. That's something that you work for.
Yeah. I mean, if he was in the league today, he'd be considered undersized. I mean, he's 6'6". Average size in the NBA is 6'8". So he'd be considered.
I mean, he was undersized. That's what I'm saying. He was that back then, that was a center's league.
Yeah.
Even Magic. Magic is 6'8", and that's a point guard. Like, the league has always been big.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's just now recently that it's become a small. Like, recently within the, like, I'll say people saw it with the Suns. Like the small ball, but even before him, Dom Nelson, like people saw it, but obviously people aren't hip to new ideas right away. And it takes a very drastic thing for people to see. So it started with Dom Nelson, then it went with D'Antoni, and then the Warriors kind of took it to a new level. And so now people are embracing small ball. But like you said, I mean, it was a big man's league at the time, and they were laughing in Jordan's at the beginning of Jordan's career saying like he could never dominate like a big man. That was the knock on him. And so until he was going out scoring 40 every night. I mean, and so
and then
a lot of things that Jordan did, I think it'd be tough. And this is another like notch in the GOAT debate for Jordan. I think a lot of stuff that he did, it'll probably never be done again. And I think the closest person to do these things, they aren't thinking about these things. So we'll go for example, Jordan has 10 scoring titles. I don't think there's any player in the league besides KD. But even if KD decided that he wanted to win 10 scoring titles, I don't think he could be just because of time and longevity in this injury now. But I think there'll never be another dude to win 10 scoring titles. There'll never be another guard to win Defensive Player of the Year. And it's just like, Ron had one shot to win the Defensive Player of the Year, which he did. He should have won it, and he didn't. But I don't think there'll never be another guard to win Defensive Player of the Year.
I mean, it can be. If you get you get the right person. There ain't really no defense at the guard spot, though. Like, really, in basketball, it ain't no defense. Now, in the NBA, like, defense
is awful.
Yeah, so, and as far as the scoring titles, I just don't think that's what players today, they're not thinking about it. Yeah, because KD, exactly. It was out of KD and Carmelo, I believe, are two players that really can get their shot in their primes when they were younger, can get their shot off anytime, anywhere, and you can't really do nothing about it, but hope they miss. And I'll put Kobe in there. Kobe would just take a stupid shot that you ain't never seen, and when he make it, he'd be like, yeah, I practiced that. Like, you work on that? Like, how am I supposed to prepare for that? But those are the players that I believe are the three players that I believe could have done it, but I don't believe that just takes too much out of you.
It takes too much. It in my opinion, it is too much. And like Phil Jackson was saying, like, I don't really think you want to win a scoring title every year if you're trying to win. You know what I'm saying? Because a lot of those shots, like, go back to James Harden. A lot of those shots, even though their offense is built that way, a lot of the shots you're taking is in detriment of the other players on your team. So I score 50, but the second highest total on your team is 9. So what are you really doing when you need everyone else to contribute? And that's what Phil Jackson tried to get Michael Jordan to understand and finally broke through and got him to understand, like, I mean, you can score 40, but we're probably going to lose. But if you score 30 or 25, we might be able to get everybody else involved and we'll be a more potent team. And that's what I respect. He had a mindset to be like, yo, listen, I need to dial back and get my teammates more involved. You know what I mean? And I think there was something very interesting that I also saw is, like, he grew as a player when he won that championship. And so people always say, oh, well, Jordan had John Paxson and Steve Kerr, you know, but those guys were standstill spot-up shooters. And Jordan always seemed to find them. So he had to make the right passes at the right time to get those guys shots. Now, I think that's another testament to his greatness because him and LeBron both, they're both very sound IQ players. Knowing what to do in the moment and at the perfect time, they both, both of their IQs are just off the charts.
I wouldn't put them in the same category IQ-wise because they do two different things. I think LeBron is more of a head coach on the floor, where Jordan found his players, but that's because it's like blatant double team coming his way. We've always talked about there's a difference between passing. There's a difference between somebody that can give it up because they're getting double teamed and somebody that can find the open man when there's really no double team. Everybody's staying at home on their man. And I just think it's a difference with those two when it comes to that.
Yeah. And LeBron, man, listen, in terms of, like you said, about, you know, setting people up and initiating offense, I don't think there's any comparison to somebody besides, if you want to go Magic Johnson or even Scottie Pippen, in terms of initiating offense and then being able to create for others. Like, that is where LeBron has a clear-cut advantage over Jordan. And I think that's a huge thing, especially being, you know, 6'9", able to see over the defense and then being able to get in the paint and penetrate without having your shot being contested by another player, you know. And listen, LeBron, I looked this stat up and I thought it was interesting, but I had to put it in context. So LeBron is the active leader in turnovers, and he's also second all time in turnovers. Now, you would see that on a surface level and be like, oh my God, he turns the ball over so much. That would be a true statement, but context is everything. And so, I mean, he has the second highest usage rate of all time, which means how much the ball is actually in his hands. So you would expect that from somebody who has the ball that much, that many times in his hands. So the second placing of turnovers all time is just like, you kind of have to take the good with the bad and take that, because he's also setting people up to get the shots. And you're not gonna make a good play every single time now. It's almost impossible.
My goal. But I'm not accepting that. Just the same way Jordan had to relinquish some of that power, I believe LeBron should have been did that. I don't think Bron should have been holding the ball as much as he did. I really believe Bron is more scarier if you bring him off of a curl picker or something like that than him holding the ball and searching for people. If you gave a constant mix-up of where LeBron was on the ball and off the ball, like a nice mix-up of that, I think that would make LeBron playing his turnovers down. But that would be my only thing I would give to Jordan, that is that he bought in. It didn't take for somebody on his level. That's the one thing I will give to Jordan over Bron. It didn't take for Scottie Pippen to get on his level for him to buy in.
Yeah.
It didn't take for Horace Grant to get on his level to buy into Phil Jackson, because, like you said, him and I can't even think of his name. Who was his coach before Phil Jackson? Phil Collins, right?
Doug Collins.
Doug Collins was his man.
Yeah.
And for him to let that go after they just figured like we felt like they're getting somewhere, and for them to get to the very next season and Jordan had to buy into a whole new system after putting 40 up a night, which you like, that is leadership.
Yep, absolutely. That is
leadership.
Took some big ego calming inside him, wherewithal inside him to be like, listen, I might have to dial back a little, because they had just come off winning a playoff series, coming out of the Eastern Conference Finals, and then they changed coaches.
Exactly. You
know? So, but then again, that goes back to your point about Jerry Krause, how, I mean, he was able to see all of these moves before it happened. Like you say, he'll never get any of the credit for any of this, but he made a lot of shrewd moves that helped Jordan get to where he was, even though they didn't hate him, but they did not like him. They clearly showed that they didn't.
You know what that reminded me of? That reminds me of the Golden State Warriors, and when they got rid of Mark Jackson and brought in Steve Kerr. It's literally the same thing. Mm-hmm. They felt like they were gaining something, brought in somebody new, and he still got the pulse of the guys and motivated them and got them to a championship.
Yep. And I wanted to piggyback off the point you made previously. You were saying it didn't take Jordan till Scottie Pippen got good for him to buy in. Phil Jackson helped him buy in, and that was it. And so that goes back to your point about LeBron, because I know you always make the point about LeBron never had a Hall of Fame coach him. And see, therein lies a difference, because say he had a Popovich, say he had a – who's the other great – a Rick Carlisle. Say he had somebody – another
but great – But I think Eric Spoelstra is on that level. Yes, absolutely. I believe he's on that level.
But he's not on Popovich or Rick Carlisle's level. He has a championship. He don't have as many as Rick Carlisle or Popovich, but he has
He got more than Rick Carlisle.
Does he? But you got to remember, Rick Carlisle won some with the Celtics. So he has one as a player. He has one as a coach. And then I think he has two as a player.
I won't agree nor disagree with that.
The point I'm trying to make is, if he had a Hall of Fame level coach that was able to help him buy in, maybe he would be the player that you were speaking of.
But that's the difference. That's the difference between him and Jordan, and that's why I'm going to give it to Jordan on that. It shouldn't take that for you to buy in.
Yeah.
That simple. It's a team sport all the way through and through. Yeah. And I hate, like, listen, I cringe when I heard Jerry Krause say it when he was like, players don't win championships, organizations do. As cringeworthy as that is, it's the truth.
Speak on that then.
Huh?
Speak on that.
Okay. He had Jordan, right? They had Jordan for about 8 years before they won the title, correct? And during those 8 years, they brung in players, correct?
Stacey
King. Did those players win with Jordan?
Horace Grant.
Yep. They did all of that, and they didn't win. And for them to get to the Eastern Conference Finals and for him to pull the plug on the coach, that's an organization. The same way Golden State Warriors did it. That's an organizational move. But the ends justify the means in this case.
Yeah. See, that's a great point. I mean, I think it's a combination of both, but, I mean, yeah, you're right. That was an organizational move. And like I said in my previous statement, like, that's a shrewd move. That's a ballsy move to take a coach that just got you to the second round, to the Eastern Conference Championship, to take that coach, take him out, and then put in another coach that hadn't even been a head coach in the NBA before? That's, I don't know.
But I will say this. It opened my eyes to players don't have as much power and authority as we think they have.
Yeah.
Because if Jordan couldn't stop Doug Collins from getting fired, come on.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah, because he said, Doug Collins used to put the ball in my hands all the time. I went from having a ball in my hands to not having it at all. He was like, come on, man. It's like, yeah, I mean, right.
But that's what – and that's why I will give it to Jordan, because in no part in time did LeBron ever come off the ball. There's there's two, like, complete different players. A player that always has the ball and a player that never has the ball. Those are two different players.
Yes.
They don't do the same thing. They don't – like, it is – like, you get two different sets of effort from those two kind of players. So, I get it, man. I got to go with Jordan, because that is buying in. And that's all you can ask your players to do.
Right. And see, it helps when the best player buys in, because then everybody around you going to buy in. So that's
they have no other choice.
Exactly. They have no other choice but to buy in. And so now
– and
go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, keep going, because I was just going to double back off what you were saying.
Oh, yeah.
I was just going to say that Kyrie – that's literally – that's the difference between Jordan and Pippen's relationship and LeBron and Kyrie's relationship.
Yeah.
Because LeBron is letting everything – he's not buying in.
Yeah.
So then once you get another superstar, and then another superstar in Kyrie, he's going to do the same thing. And it's going to be a nasty effect.
Yeah, clash. I mean, that relationship, though, it was just like I told you before, man, I give LeBron so much – I give him some eggs in the GOAT debate for having to deal with Kyrie, because
– But that's the monster he built.
That's a good point. I mean, you could make that point that I was a monster he built, but, I mean, Kyrie, he's a different dude, man, and – everyone says that about him. Like, he's a different guy. He's a different guy. He's mad. He's really moody and all this other stuff. And it's just like, for you to be in a playoff series, a finals run, excuse me, and not talk to your team the whole playoff series, like, that is a different level of, like, agitated, to not talk to your teammates, the people you see every day, to not talk to them for the whole finals, and then y'all go out and win a championship. For LeBron to have to deal with that.
I mean, but that's part of being professional.
Yeah.
That's part of being professional.
Yep.
That's literally why they get paid the big bucks, to deal with stuff like that.
And
still come out and perform at the highest level.
I don't know how he got through that season, bro. Like,
it's not that hard to play with niggas that's mad at you. It ain't. It's because we got plays to run, so I don't gotta say nothing to you. We just running plays.
Yeah.
You want the ball? Here.
I think
it ain't hard.
The most.
I mean, Shaq and Kobe did it. It's been done.
Yeah, but they hated each other off the court, but they came together to win. I guess that's the same thing, but they literally hated each other off the court. I mean, Shaq and Kobe literally fought each other, like literally came to blows. So
yeah, I mean, but have you ever seen that one interview when they asked Kyrie, was LeBron his father figure? Like,
oh, dude, you can see the disgust. He was so right. He was so disgusted. Like, what?
Like, you can literally see the wheels turning. Like, yo, I'm out of here. Like, y'all asking, my dad? I'm out of here.
All she asked was, is LeBron a father figure on the team? It wasn't like he was asking, was he his father? He was asking, was he a father
he took
on
it.
The team? And he just was so disgusted at the comment. Like, no, my father's name is Jedrick Irving. And that's it.
Yeah.
It was his quest for people to respect him. And the thing about it was when Kyrie was going through all this and he was trying to earn his respect, I totally understood, as a person who's been an underdog, I understood exactly where he was coming from. I just didn't like the way he went about it. But I totally understand wanting your respect, though. Like, even
I'll say that, but all basketball players are moody. Yeah, all of them.
Every single one of them. I always
all of them.
This is no disrespect to the basketball players, because I love you guys. But you guys are the most sensitive athletes there are on the face of this earth. The football players, soccer players, whatever the case may be, you guys are sensitive, bro. Somebody tell you y'all can't make an open jumper or something, that's like saying, that's like fighting words, bro.
I mean, but that's like, because you do it for so long, it's literally like it's part of you. Basketball is really a lifestyle zone, because once you do it, it's not something that you could just do once. Yeah. Once a week here, and then another month. It's like, nah, that's something that you do all the time.
And the one thing I hate about basketball players the most is it's tough for basketball players to accept criticism for someone, and this may be in life for anyone, actually. It's tough for them to accept criticism from someone who isn't as good as them, but they even know that they're 100% right. Even though you know that in your heart, you won't want to hear it from somebody that's not as good as you.
But that's why I give it to Jordan, because Phil Jackson had no credentials. So,
well, he won two titles as a player. He had credentials.
No, I mean, as a coach, though, that's completely different.
Oh, as a coach, right. You're right, yeah.
He had no credentials as a coach. Like, yeah. He not even in the NBA coaching.
Yeah.
He was – where was he, in Puerto Rico?
He was in Puerto Rico, yep.
Yeah, oh, so –
Mexico. From that, he was in Mexico.
Yeah, Mexico. So, to go from to take the ball out of my hand, and you ain't never coached an NBA player, but I'm going to still do this anyway because that's what's best for the team?
Yeah. I mean, but to give some context to whoever didn't watch the documentary, I mean, it showed that Phil Jackson was working with Tex Winter and learning the game and learning how to build the triangle, you know, over years and years, and trying to explain this. Like, maybe Doug Collins would have kept his job if he would have listened to Phil Jackson and started implementing some of the triangle stuff. Maybe he would have kept his job, but who knows if Michael Jordan would have been the Michael Jordan that we all know and love today. So it's just crazy how, like you said, going back to your original point of how, you know, he had to make a ballsy move, because even in those interviews, you could hear how ticked off Doug Collins was. And he was like, yeah, I got a sense that Phil could be the coach. And the dude said, how did you know? I just got a sense. It's just like he knew he wasn't trying to change, so he knew, like, it was either him or me. So he thought Phil Jackson would fail, presumptively, is what I'm presuming. He felt like Phil Jackson would fail if he was the coach. So,
and that's what I'm saying. You're not going – that's anybody, though. Like, it's hard to change when everything is good. I don't know anybody that just be like, you know what, everything's good. Let me change everything about my life. Like, those are big – those are big decisions. Those are that's a lot of money involved. And it's like, how do you explain that to somebody? Because that's all GMs do. They just the middleman to the owner.
Yeah.
So how do you tell him, like, yo, I know we just went to the Eastern Conference Finals, but we got to get rid of him. And we got to go with the guy that's sitting next to him.
No, not even sitting next to him. Because Tex Winter, he was the assistant coach, but they moved him to the scoring table because he was talking too much. He was the assistant to the assistant.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and that's what I'm saying. Like, that's why I cringe. Like, I literally, I'm going to keep saying it.
Yeah.
I cringe when Jerry Krause said, players don't win championships, organizations do. But that is an organizational move. For anyone to take, okay, we are literally 5 games away from winning a championship. 5 wins. And now you're telling me I'm going to get rid of that coach. We're going to change every way that we're playing basketball on the office of it. And we're going to keep the same team.
Yeah. And that was like, that's literally all they tweaked too. They just had a different philosophy of scoring points. And then they adopted a more active approach on defense. I mean, that's all coaching. Which brings me to the part of the GOAT debate, or this documentary, whichever one you want to culminate. I think this documentary also showed how Jordan accepted the challenge. You know, Kobe always talks about accepting the challenge and how Jordan always accepted the challenge. And this documentary showed, like, Jordan just wanted to win. So I always try to exclaim to basketball players, especially these young dudes, that basketball is just not a one side of the court game. Yes, it's nice to
score. It is now,
but usually, 90% of the time, if you don't play good defense, you won't win. Usually is how it goes. Now, I think the best players, like, if you really say that I'm nice, like, if someone tells me you're nice, like, you try to, like, you explained to me a long time ago, you say, yo, everybody can score. So it's not really, like, an impressive thing, because everybody has their way of scoring. You're either an ISO player, or you're a movement player, three-point shooter, back to the basket, mid-post, whatever the case is, everyone can score. So what else are you doing to affect the basketball game? And so this is where I differentiate from Jordan and LeBron. This is what holds weight for me is, you know, are you accepting that challenge on the defensive end? You know, there was a time that LeBron was hands down the best player and then like one of the best defensive players in the league. And then when he left when he left Miami and went to Cleveland, he just all of a sudden stopped playing defense.
He was done with defense.
Exactly. By his own admission, if you look at the sound bites he had this year, he said, I'm actually playing defense this year. They showed that soundbite, and I saw it. I'm like, yo, so he really – like, we can all speculate whether or not he's playing defense or not, but he really was like
– No, that ain't – I told you that ain't speculation because right. – You know I got that switch anywhere. I could just be like, you know what? I can take a couple plays off.
Yeah.
And you can – but you can see that in regular – you can see that in people that hoop. You can see that when – you just see – you can see effort. Effort is very, very visible.
Right. And so to sit and then actually confirm to the people like, yes, last year and years prior, no, I was not playing defense. Like that resonates with me because – Jordan accepted the challenge every night. I'm not sitting here saying that he had the best, the hardest assignment every night, but he did defend. And there is no question about it that he did defend. I mean,
it's an effort thing.
Yeah. And so, like, there's a lot of times LeBron's effort comes into question, you know what I mean, because he doesn't play defense. And I was having a conversation with a coach one time, and I was having the same conversation, like, yo, I mean, if he's not playing defense, how can I call him the GOAT if he willingly not plays defense? I understand that he has a smaller workload, but it goes back to your point about accepting playing off the ball. It's just like, if you're just going to sit and not play defense and stand in the corner and not, like, play to your fullest capability, how can I actually call you the GOAT? When I got a guy that led the league in steals three times. He led the league in steals three times, and he's ninth all time. I want to get this correct. I want to look at his steals. He's third all time in steals. So it's like, how can I say that LeBron's the GOAT? We both know that they can score. We both know that they can pass, whatever the case may be. One does more than the other. That's fine. But where you get separated is what you do on the defensive end. So how can I call LeBron the GOAT if he willingly admitted that for a stretch of time in his career, he didn't play defense? That's where it stops for me.
I'll tell you why. Because we'll talk about this word that I told you before is politics, where you're telling me LeBron played the season where he deserved Defensive Player of the Year and didn't win it. That'll stop anybody from playing defense on that level, especially because defense is not easy.
Because
effort is visible when you're playing defense. But that effort isn't the only thing. That takes a lot of brain work. Like, you have to really think that you have to think about every move that your opponent is going to make before they make it.
Right.
You got to make sure you slide in the right place. That takes a lot of wear and tear on you.
Right.
So I get it. I can get why not chasing it, because I'm pretty sure that Jordan had not got it one of those years, he'd be like, I'm not going to put the same amount of effort into it.
Well, Jordan only got Defensive Player of the Year once, which
– No, I'm saying anything. Say one of them seasons – no, because he said it. I don't know. It can go either way. Because he said that one time he didn't win – no, he took it out on finals MVP when Chuck won MVP.
Yeah.
And then he waited till the finals and then, all right, I'm going to show you who the MVP
is. Yeah, right. I'm going to show you. Man, listen.
It's a challenge, but I can get how not getting the credit for that, for accepting that challenge on a nightly basis and make you be like, nah, I don't want to play defense no more.
Yeah. But I mean, I feel like most of the time with LeBron, it's at the detriment of his team that he doesn't play defense.
Okay.
There was a time I remember when they played – remember when they played the Bulls in the Eastern Conference Finals? And it was that one – I can't remember what game it was, but it was when the game went into overtime. And I remember the whole overtime, bro. LeBron guarded Derrick Rose the whole overtime. Perimeter, wherever he went, LeBron went. And I was like – and at that time, I was saying – I was like, yo, this dude is the best defender in the league. And your point is very accurate. If I'm putting that type of defensive effort into guarding one of the most athletic point guards this league has probably ever seen, shut him down in a Eastern Conference Finals game, and I still don't get the credit I deserve, you're right. That probably would make you stop playing defense like that. But I remember, like, and the thing is, I'm only bringing that up because I feel like he could have still played defense that way, but he just chose not to.
Oh, no, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, he clearly he could have. He's doing it now.
Yeah. Well, he's kind of doing it now. I mean, he's playing defense this year. I won't lie. He's playing defense.
No, but I'm not expecting him to be on the same level as 5 years ago.
No. Oh, no. 5 years ago, bro, he was the best help and perimeter defender at one point in time.
So, I won't put him in that boat. But yeah, I mean, that's the only excuse I can come up with it. But then on the same token, defense is part of the game.
It's a part of and it's an important part of the game. Like you said, it's not as important now because teams just try to outscore you every game, which is weak. But I mean, pretty much, you know, I mean, that's a very, very, very important part of the game. Like, if you can't stop anybody, like, I don't understand how you win. I mean, that's why James Harden doesn't win every year, because everyone says, oh, he plays such great defense. And it's like, yes, he plays defense to a fault. I've never seen James Harden guard the best player on the opposite.
And I think that's on our last pod that we did, where we talked to whatever pod we talked about Russell. And he was like, Russell's this lockdown defender. But you seen how you gave me one moment where LeBron locked down someone. That's all I'm looking for any player. It just takes you to do it one time in a series, really.
Yeah.
If you can show me that you can lock somebody down in a playoff series, that's another level.
Well, LeBron didn't do it for a series. I just remember that moment, that overtime game. I remember him, guarding Derrick Rose for that whole overtime and going with him step for step, bro, while they was all tired. And like I said, I don't like Derrick Rose like that. Everyone knows me. No, I don't like Derrick Rose like that because I feel he's overrated. But I never questioned his athletic ability. Like, that dude was dumb athletic. And for LeBron to just stick with him through the whole overtime, I was amazed by that. And that's why I bring it up. But the fact from that point until now for him to not play defense, I can't give him the edge. That's the thing. I can't give him the edge in the GOAT debate if we're nitpicking, because that's what we're doing now. We're just nitpicking now. And I know Jordan was going to give me that effort on a nightly basis on defense. Whether it was guarding the best player or whether it was help defense and playing passing lanes and getting steals, like, Jordan did it all. You know what I'm saying? And that's why he gonna have that GOAT debate, bro. He gonna have it until we see another player come around and do what MJ's done. But
I just rank it different because Jordan, even though he won Defensive Player of the Year one time, he was never the greatest defensive player on his team. Probably his rookie season. But anytime, as soon as Scotty came, he was not. That's how Scotty got his time by pushing the ball up and playing defense. It wasn't scoring. It wasn't because he was the greatest rebounder then, because he was all skin and bone.
Yeah. Yeah, man. Scotty definitely, like, changed the game for Mike in terms of making it easy on him. No, he didn't have to guard the best player. He could just play passing lanes and he could just be smart and rotate like that. That definitely takes – it's like you said, it's tough playing defense, but, like, to have somebody else take that burden off you and everybody knows their role and accepts that role, that's more valuable. That's why – and to make a point, that's why you were saying that the Golden State Warriors losing Draymond may have been more detrimental than them losing KD, because, you know, what Draymond does is way more auspicious for the team, because, you know, we know KD want to score, but you need that guy –
That's going to get to him.
Right, exactly.
Just think of how trash Shaq would be if no point guard can get him the ball.
Right, yeah.
Because then we would just say he a big man that can't do nothing but dunk.
Yeah.
We wouldn't call him as dominant because he didn't get the ball as many times.
Yeah. So, as we come to the end, what is your overall thoughts on Michael Jordan? What's your overall thoughts on the documentary as it comes to a close? And then what is your overall thoughts between Jordan and LeBron now after watching the documentary?
I mean, I just want episodes 9 and 10 to be as good as the first 8. That's it. That is it. And as far as the debate, I'm still going to go with Bron. But it gives me respect on the work ethic of Jordan, because I think I've probably – I probably haven't put that in my equation, but I'm a big guy that's what I like. I like effort. I like you working hard when no one's looking.
Right. And that's definitely.
And that's what Jordan did. Like, every story whether it's basketball training, baseball training, he put in the work.
Yep.
And that's one thing we can't take from him. We can't take what you put in.
Mm-hmm.
And that's I just gained more respect in that manner for Jordan.
And that's kind of what I'm taking from this documentary too. It's just like, you know, the work that he put in was just unmatched. And it's crazy how someone's work ethic can affect so many people. Like, people that don't even know you. Like, all you got to do is work hard, and then somebody, I don't know, films it or whatever the case may be, shows you how hard this person works, and then it can affect so many people in such a macro level. And so I will take Jordan 10 times out of 10 for the GOAT debate, just because the stuff he had to deal with, the consistency, the unblemished finals record, the making his teammates better, the acceptance of coaching, the defensive prowess. It's just, there's too many things that I can't nitpick Michael Jordan about. If you want to nitpick someone's leadership style, that's a personal preference thing. That's a thing that's like internal within you. It's all about what you think. But in terms of like pure basketball, I don't know if I can really nitpick at some of the things Michael Jordan did. Maybe the fact that Gary Payton shut him down once, I guess. Maybe that's the only thing I can nitpick. But in terms of overall consistency through – also what I want to add into, and I want to be fair, is that Jordan did take a year out of the game to play baseball, which – so when after he won a championship, he took a year off to retire.
Hold on.
Once.
Keep
going.
Keep going.
So once he did that, I think that helped him. But
I'm doing it, sure.
What you said, what?
Let me get this. I was talking to somebody else. You're gonna have to edit this out.
Oh, I gotta do a super edit again. Oh
yeah, my bad.
But yeah. So I think Jordan gonna always have it for me. Until somebody else comes along and do it. I don't really feel like if LeBron wins a championship with the Lakers, multiple, I think that's the only way he can overstep Jordan. That's the only way. And then I don't see a player that's coming up that's going to be able to do it. Unless you see a player that's going to be able to do it, that's coming up.
Devin Booker.
Don't front on Book. Don't front on Book like that.
Book ain't no winner, man.
You can say that after 2 years in the league.
No. What championship?
Yeah, right. Name some of Book's great teams.
Listen, I'm gonna tell you this. Book was a sixth man at Kentucky. What they won?
They didn't win a national championship. I know that.
All right. Like, but as good as Book is and great as he is, he was a sixth man. All right. When Book done. I don't think Book going to go down
as a winner. I think Book's the only player that can win 10 scoring titles. Even though I think it won't be done, I think he might be the only player that can win 10 scoring titles. KD's kind of coming to the end of his career.
I think KD – you know how much I love KD, but I think KD done.
Done? As in, like, won't be good again?
Not won't be good again, but he won't be able to say, I'm Kevin Durant.
Wow, that's a bold statement.
I'm taking it all off injury. I'm taking it all off injury. That's literally what killed Isaiah's career, Isaiah Thomas. It killed, I want to say, Penny. Or it was.
Oh, it
just a couple players.
No question about it.
It's killed a couple people's career. Even you know who I watched this year for the Achilles injury on their comeback was Mike Conley, and Mike Conley doesn't look like the same player at all.
I agree. He doesn't.
And but that's the player that makes the cuts that KD makes.
Yeah. I mean, that Achilles injury, there has not been a player that has come back successfully from that injury yet. That's a debilitating injury. But maybe this time between playing, he said he's not coming back this year, so he's going to have a whole year out of basketball. So I don't know. I don't know, man. Basketball takes is a game more so than working on it every day. It's a game of rhythm and timing. And you can shoot all the shots in the gym if you want, but getting out there and playing and then shooting those same shots against live defense, like dudes that's actually like trying to foul you and try to kill your shot, is the difference between shooting that and then shooting in the gym with no defense. So it's going to take him a minute. Even though he says, well, I've been playing basketball my whole life, but yeah, you still got to get back into the rhythm and the timing of the game. And with an Achilles injury at, what is he, 33 now or 30?
Yeah, I got what? So we said 35?
Yeah.
KD got about 2 more years on top. And yeah, that's why I said I don't think he'll be the player that he was even last year.
I just hope he don't, because I would like to see him win a title, but I just hope he don't fall off the cliff too quick, too soon.
It's not his game that I'm doing. It's all injury, because you got to think about, all right, he, while building up that leg, he's going to do some damage to his other leg, because you got to use your legs to walk.
Right.
And that's like literally you got to put all your weight on that other leg.
It was like when Jordan broke his foot and he went back to they let him go back to North Carolina, and one of his casts was stronger than the other. And they was like, yo, what you been doing, bro?
That's it.
And he was like, yo, I've been playing. So, I mean, I guess I can see that same kind of thing happening, but it's going to be interesting to see what basketball looks like when it comes back. Cause,
man, it's any sport, really. I don't think we're going to get a sport in 2020.
I hope that's not true.
I hope so too.
But basketball, football is supposed to be opening up May 18th or something. I think they're supposed to be opening their facilities back. But I'm more along the lines of thinking like Shaq, like, just scrap this whole season and let's just start fresh. Because if a team wins a championship, like if LeBron wins a championship, I'm not really going to count this. I'm really not going to count this.
Listen, I'm going to tell you this. It's a bunch of people that don't count Kevin Durant titles. Guess what? They still his. They still got his name on it. They still got engraved.
He hit all the big shots in those finals. What do you mean?
No.
You don't count these finals. He literally
I said some people, not me. Not me.
Oh, he hit 50% of the big shots in the finals. Steph played like crap.
Okay, I'll give you another scenario. Dallas Mavs winning the title on a shortened season. Did you put an asterisk next to their name?
But they're not going to win the title. That's the thing. They're not.
No, I said they did win the title on a shortened season. Oh. Dirk did.
Oh, yes, that's right. They did lock out that year. No, I don't put an asterisk on that. Because it didn't happen in season. It happened before the season. So no one has – they started the season late. It wasn't like they started the season.
There is no disadvantage. Nobody has a disadvantage at this point. Exactly. Everybody was in basketball shape, and they got 2 months off. Say they get 2 to 3 months off. There is no disadvantage.
Some dudes don't have access to gyms. Some dudes don't have access. How you're a basketball player and don't have a professional
access to a gym is – that's bull. Yeah, I don't see that at all.
Like, you can't just say, yo, let me get this gym by myself for 2 hours out of the day. That is beyond –
I mean, bro, if you – first of all, in this quarantine, if you know anybody with keys to any gym, I'm pretty sure they'll let you get it, especially if you're an NBA pro. They know it's your job.
An NBA pro does not have access to a gym. Like they said, Giannis wasn't working out. I was like, how? How is he not working out? Giannis is like the most up-and-coming star in the NBA. How does he, of all people, not have a gym to work out at?
They're just being lazy.
Yeah, clearly, just being lazy. Like, I'm just – when I hear that, so I'm like, how? How? How is this? But, again,
I get it. Once you're done – usually, that's when players, like, once the season is over, that's when players really become themselves.
Right, they start sitting on the game, playing Fortnite and Call of Duty,
and telling people that he's playing going to Golden State.
Yeah, right, man, he got hacked. And when I saw all that, I knew immediately he had got hacked. None of that stuff even sounds like Giannis.
All right. And once he end up in Golden State,
we all gonna be sick. We gonna be sick. I know I'm gonna be sick. I don't want
to. Listen, if he go to Golden State, I'm gonna stop believing anybody that say they hacked.
Right.
This is gonna have a detrimental effect on my whole life if Giannis go to Golden State.
But that wouldn't be a good move for them to even get him. Yes, he's
Yes, dominant. It would. Yes, it would.
I don't think so. Does he fit in their scheme?
Yeah.
How? He can shoot?
No. Okay. So you have Steph, you have Klay, correct?
Yes.
You have the ball in Draymond's hand, correct?
Yes.
You have Giannis setting a pick for either one of those two and cut into the basket. What is the defense going to do?
Nothing, but there comes a point in time where someone's going to adjust and make him be the guy that's going to have to beat them by shooting jumpers, and then what's going to happen?
No, but see, that's the difference. He can score on his man one-on-one. The thing is when Giannis loses, because I will always say this, and I'm going to say it again, is because he depends on his teammates way too much. And for the star power that he – like, I don't believe in Chris Middleton. I don't believe in Brooke Lopez. Basically, the one person I believed in was Brogdon, and they got rid of him.
Yep.
So, if you then, like I said, this is the same thing as Golden State. Once you take away the weaker link, so who was the center this year?
I can't remember. Yo, they're garbage. I don't. Why are we even
exactly? Exactly. So if you take that, you take their center out now. I'll say Looney. Uh-huh. So then you have a new starting lineup of. Yo, this sounds crazy. Steph, Klay, Andrew, Draymond, and the Greek Freak.
Yeah, that's a very versatile starting lineup right there.
First of all, you got Giannis and you got Draymond on defense. And then you got the Splash Brothers. And then you got Andrew Wiggins just being there with all the bungees in the world to just play freely.
Yeah, see, Andrew Wiggins has no expectations, which is scary to even think about.
Because it's a very scary sight.
We clearly know he isn't the guy. We have established that he is not the guy. But he could definitely thrive in a place where he doesn't have to be the man.
Where he's the fourth man getting the ball, he can thrive.
I would like to see that. I would not like to see Giannis be a Golden State Warrior, but I would like to see Andrew Wiggins be able to play stress-free. Maybe he could.
It makes sense, though. That's all I'm going to say. It makes a lot of sense when you think about it, because if you let Draymond play the point, like, yeah, and you have Giannis setting the pick. Okay, so if you help for Draymond, I mean, if you help for Giannis, that means you have three people that can shoot. Or even if you don't think Andrew Wiggins can shoot, you got two lethal shooters that they have to account for. And then you have to account for Giannis going to the brim. Wait, not because then you can't put a wall up, because now they can just throw it over for an alley.
It's definitely a fun thought to play around with and explore, but I would not like that. As an NBA fan, I would not like that. They probably would have, and the thing about it, they probably would have some crazy team chemistry, because we know Steph and Klay, they're very unselfish, and so is Draymond. And so they would have no problems with him scoring 25 a night or 30 a night. I'm putting up the same number.
KD was putting up 40 in the finals. They won't mind anything that he brings.
Exactly. They let him do what he do. And just, like, if all they got is just open threes off of all his penetration and all his buckets or whatever.
They will live with that.
Exactly. They'll love that. So I would hate to
say. Especially with them coming off of injuries, too. Yeah. What?
Yeah, that's a thought I don't wanna sit here and ponder.
I'm just telling you, said it wouldn't help them or benefit them. No, that's him playing is a great benefit to them. Well, and it's the best move for him, because then he will have teammates that he can depend on.
It would be great, but I would hate to see that for the NBA. Just like when Kevin Durant went there, I would want to see that, because we need a competitive league. And I would take them. I probably wouldn't take them over the Clippers, but I would take them over the Lakers.
Okay.
Yeah. I like that. But
hey, I'm gonna let you know your boy is getting killed during this quarantine.
Who?
Paul George.
What do you do now?
They have no respect for his game.
Yeah, which is beyond me. That's one of the things. While I'm sitting here, before we close out, I need to discuss this real quick. Okay, so this is what happened. So Kendrick Perkins said that he would take Pascal Siakam over Paul George. Now, that is probably the most asinine thing I've probably done. Just because, now, while Siakam has definitely, most certainly gotten better, and I will definitely acknowledge that, he got better. He played solid in the finals. He was an all-star starter this year. Not a reserve. He was an all-star starter. So he definitely got better. But as I told Chester, how can you say that a dude who just got good within the last 2 years, right? We'll say Pascal been good for the last 2 years. Paul George been the best player on a team that's been to the Eastern Conference Finals. He's been, in my opinion, he's been a top five player for the majority of his career. Whether you want to agree with me or not, go back and look at Paul George's skill set. He's hitting a lot of big shots. When he came off injury, when he broke his leg and came back and changed his number to 13, that's when he stopped hitting big shots. Then, last year in Oklahoma City, his last year, he tore both of his shoulders. That's why he had offseason shoulder surgery on both his shoulders. So he was not healthy. But this past year, his final year in OKC, he was in the running for Defensive Player of the Year, and he was in the running for MVP. Tell me when Pascal Siakam has ever done that or will ever do that. Tell me when.
Listen, you know Paul George, my boy. I seen it early. And I just don't understand where the hate is coming from.
I don't understand. He hasn't performed in the playoffs the way people would like the last couple of years, but that's because he's been hurt. He hurt both of his shoulders. You can't even shoot. And he was
It's hard to play basketball with two bum shoulders.
And then he had surgery in the offseason. So what y'all want him to do? The man been hurt. You know what I'm saying? But for y'all.
Hey, listen, but that's what happens. Injuries are hard.
For people to take it so far and say, oh, Pascal Siakam's better than him, it's just like.
Listen. Injuries are a part of the game. You got to equate those.
Part of the game. But if I'm not at a level where I can perform my highest, how can you judge me accurately then? You know what I'm saying? Like if I can't shoot with both my shoulders, how and he was, and on top of that, he was still out there too.
The funniest part is that he was in the running for MVP last year.
And defensive player.
Pascal won best improved player. Yeah, like, it's a whole
different been level. Past that stage. Been past most improved stage. What are y'all even talking about? Like, I don't. People be having people just saying anything, bro. I really
anything, man. Anything.
And so that's why I'm glad my viewers tune into the Hammer Turkey. We talk about real basketball with people who know what the heck they're talking about. And as we come to a close on this YouTube video, I appreciate all of the viewers for watching us on YouTube. Downloading the podcast. We're on every single streaming site except Tidal, so you can have the Ham and Turkey on the go. So please, after this, you watch this video, please subscribe, share this video. Please help me get my likes up so we can continue to make great content and be seen by more than 1 or 12 people. I want it to be seen by all the people who feel they have a take, because I personally feel that fans have a voice too. And if you are a person who is knowledgeable about the game of basketball or football, those are the sports I stick to because those are the ones I know the best, I want you to hit me on any of my social media. At the end of this video, I will place all my social media platforms where you can hit me and talk to me and say, hey, I want to come on the Ham and Turkey and discuss my team or a basketball topic or debate topics very astutely. If you want to do that, just hit me up and I will make it so you will be able to come on here and talk. So again, I thank all my viewers for listening. And again, this is the Ham and Turkey.
My boy.
I'm still recording. I gotta edit this part out.
Oh, yeah. Yo, listen. My phone went from 90 to 6.